Hello, student. This is class 5, calculus 2. In the previous class, we learned Taylor series approximation, and as an important example of Taylor series approximation, we learned Campbell-Schuller linearization. Sometimes we call Campbell-Schuller linearization as CS linearization. And we have interesting link, very good link about CS linearization. Let's take a look at it.
So next step, I want to do exactly the same thing I did in a one-period setting in a multi-period setting, something that works for long-lasting securities. First, a return identity in logs, and then a present value formula in logs. And we'll use it in the same way to understand our long horizon regressions. Okay, first step is the Campbell-Schiller linearized return identity. Let's meet it. Here's what it says. Return, log return, is approximately rho, which is a number like about 0.96, times tomorrow's log price-dividend ratio plus dividend growth minus today's price-dividend ratio. Intuitively, it's not saying anything unusual. It's saying, how do you get a good return? You get a good return by prices being high tomorrow, by getting a lot of dividends, or prices being low today. So it's saying something completely reasonable. And all it is a log linearization of the definition of return. There's no theory in here, it's just the definition of return. So how do you do that? Well, there's the return. The return is price plus dividend over price. Express that in terms of price dividend ratios and dividend growth rates. Take logs, little letters are logs of big letters. The trouble here, of course, is you have the log of 1 plus something, which isn't 1 plus the log of something. To do that, we take a first order Taylor expansion. And since we're interested in variances and covariances, we'll drop the constants in everything we do after the fact. And so the log linearized version of the definition of return is just the Campbell-Schiller return identity. That'll be useful in many, many different places, or in as well as in deriving the present value identity. So that's the first formula you need to remember. Next formula. Let's turn that into a present value identity the same way we did in a one-period model. We're going to pull the price to the left and try to put the other stuff on the right. So we've got the return identity. What do we do? Put the price on the left, the other stuff on the right, price today, price tomorrow, other stuff, and then just iterate that thing forward. That's where the rho to the j form, the rho to the j minus 1 terms come from. So what do we get now? Price dividend ratio today, sum of rho to the j minus 1 future dividend growth, future returns, and k. I just did it k times forwards. Now we'll talk a little bit about sending this last term to 0. Rho is a number less than 1, so long as price dividend ratios don't explode, that thing goes to 0, and we'll think a little bit more deeply about the economics of that. But putting that in place for the moment, you have the Campbell-Schiller present value. We have the Campbell-Schiller return identity, and it results in the Campbell-Schiller present value identity. Now, like the return identity, it's just an identity. The only content here is the definition of return. It holds ex post as well as ex ante. And you can see that in a sense, this is really just a definition of long run return. What gives you returns in the long run? Well, returns in the long run come from a low price or from lots of future dividends. In the long run, you eat the dividends, you don't sell it. So it's just the definition of return. Anything that holds ex post, again, also holds ex ante. So price dividend ratio is expected dividend growth and expected return, and we have a present value formula. Now, it's linear present value formula, which is very nice. We have the expected dividend growth, and we discount them. We have the ability to have time-varying discount rates by time-varying returns, but these all enter linearly. A whole term structure of expected returns can now affect prices. And it says the same thing. Where do high prices come from? They come from either high expectations of future dividend growth or from low expectations of future returns, from low risk premium, from being willing to hold prices despite low returns. That makes hold assets despite low returns. That gives you high prices at low returns. But you see now, of course, that prices, that expectations far in the future can raise prices today. So it's a beautiful linearized present value formula, which we'll be able to use to put together observations about prices, long-run dividend growth, and long-run returns.
Okay, great lecture. Today, first we will learn partial derivative. In general, the partial derivative of an n array vector, an array function f x1 xn in the direction of xi at the point a1 to an is defined to be partial, we read this one as partial, we read it as partial f over partial x I at point a1 to an, which is limit of h goes to 0, and f a1 to ai plus h an minus f a1 to an over h. In the above differential, quotient, all the variables except xi are held constant, held fixed. That choice of fixed value determines the function of one variable. Okay? So f a1 to a I minus 1 and a I plus 1 to a n and xi equals f a1 to a I minus 1, they are fixed, and xi varying a I plus 1 to a n, and by definition, this is derivative only with respect to xi, because we treat all other variables constant. So basically, it is derivative with xi, then we fix other term constant, so it is partial f over partial xi. So intuitively, for multivariate function, partial derivative means we change only one variable out of many variables. This is partial derivative. So let's take a look at the partial derivative. The volume of a cone. So cone looks like this. The volume of a cone depends on a height, and the radius. Radius and height, 1/3, right? So the volume V of a cone depends on the cone's height and its radius R. According to formula, pi r squared, this is the size of the bottom, and multiplied by h. Then it is a cylinder, but it is cone, not cylinder, so we divide it 1/3. It is 1/3. Cone is 1/3 of a cylinder. So pi r squared h divided by 3. Now the partial derivative of v with respect to r is, basically, we treat all the others constant, and we only change r. So partial v or the partial r is, we take derivative with respect to r squared, so 2r becomes 2r, so 2 pi r h over 3, which represents the rate with which a constant volume changes if its radius varied. So when radius changes by small amount, basically this number shows how much volume changes. Now, the partial derivative with respect to h equals to pi r squared over 3, because we now take derivative only with h and retreat other things as constant. So we have pi r squared over 3, which represents the rate with which the volume changes if its height is varied and its radius is kept constant. So let's take a look at this Wikipedia link. Yes, partial derivative, a lot of partial derivative notations. And then basic definitions. Yep. Example. Another notation, they are all good. Yeah. And high order partial derivative. We can even define high order partial derivative. So first partial, the second partial, we take partial derivative of the first partial derivative. It is so fxx, it is second partial derivative. Next, total derivative. Now, what is the total derivative? Total derivative is basically the sum of partial derivatives. So, the sum of the partial differentials with respect to all of the independent variables is called the total differential. So, dy, how much y change? Where y change if individual x change? So, dy is partial y over partial x1 multiplied by change of x1 and plus dot 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 plus partial y over partial xn and a change of xn. So let's take a look at some examples. Find the total differential of w when w is x power over 3yz plus xy plus z plus 3, and then we want to find the total differential of this one at the point 1 to 3. Okay, so in order to get total differential, first we get partial differential for each x, y, z, right? Because total differential is sum of, basically product sum of partial derivatives and partial changes, right? So the total differential at point x0, y0, z0, dw is w partial x, and at the point x0, y0, z0, and the change of the change of x dx plus partial y, partial w over partial y, and x0, y0, z0, and dy plus wz, x0, y0, z0, and dz. In our case, partial w over partial x, wx, we take derivative of this one with only with x, then you get 3x squared yz plus y. Now, partial w partial y, well, we have y over here, so it is x 3, x to the power 3z plus x. And then wz is this here, and constant, so they become 1, and it goes away, so wz is x3y plus 1. Now we evaluate those partial derivatives at 1, 2, 3. So wx 1, 2, 3, so you plug 1, 2, 3 over here, then wx becomes 20, wy is 4, wz is 3, therefore dw equal 20dx plus 4dy plus 3dz. Next, let's take a look at another example. Now, this is another interesting one. Okay, so suppose w, okay, w equal x 3yz xyz 3, so basically same to above, but here x is 3 cosine t, y is 3 sine t, z is 2t, and then we want to compute dw over dt and evaluate them at t is x pi over 2. Well, then we basically are using chain rule, okay? So dw dt is partial w partial x dx dt, and then partial w partial y and dy dt, so this is basically chain rule, and then d partial w partial z and dz dt, so we have this one. Now, first, this partial wx and wy and wz we already got here, so we plug this one, wx, wy, wz into this one here. And then we have to calculate dx dt, dy dt, dz dt. But, you know, if we take derivative of cosine function, it is minus of sine function. And if we take derivative of sine function, it is cosine function. Well, take derivative of 2t with t is 2, so 2. And 3 cosine t, and this is 3 minus sine t, minus 3 sine t over here. So it looks like this one. Now, we plug t equal pi 2. Then, when t equal pi over 2, cosine pi over 2 is 0. And then sine pi over 2 is 1, like this one. And then 2 multiplied by pi over 2 is basically same to pi. So we plug over here. So we have 3 values. So we plug them. Okay, so we know x, y, z. So this, we plug this x, y, z over this over here. And we know these values. Sine pi over 2 equals 1. Cosine pi over 2 is 0. So we plug all those values. So basically, dwdt at pi equal 2 is minus 7. So total derivative is very useful, like this one. So let's take a look at the Wikipedia link. Yeah, total derivative. Yes, we have interesting example like this. Differentiate with indirect dependencies. We just did it. Yes, so for example, suppose fxy is xy, and then partial f over partial x is y. And suppose we are constrained to the line y is x, then it will be x squared, right? X squared. In that case, the total derivative of f with respect to x is just 2x. Well, we can get the same one with total derivative of t. Instead of immediately substituting y in terms of x, this can be found equivalently using the chain rule. So df over dy equal partial f over partial x, partial f over partial x plus partial f over partial y, and y is a function of x, so dy dx. The later part, this part is chain rule, and then this part is y, okay? Because partial, we take derivative of x, it is y, so we plug this one over here. Right, this one over here, that's y, and this second part, partial f, partial y, then we take derivative of this one, this y, we have only x, so x, and dy dx, this is 1, because y is 1, so y plus x, but y equal x, so basically x plus y and 2x. Notice that this is not equal to partial derivative. Okay, so total derivative f with respect to x is 2x, but only partial is y. Okay, y which is x, so they are different. Intuitively, that is straightforward. If we calculate partial, we measure change when y is constant. But for total derivative, we take into account both direct effect or indirect effect. Directly affect f, and then indirectly affect f through y, so it is a direct effect, indirect effect. So partial derivative basically captures only this direct part, total derivative captures this direct part and the indirect part. Okay? And we have this one, and the total derivative by differentials, they are all good examples. Now, let's learn very important concept called the gradient. Gradient is a very important concept. Now, the gradient. Gradient is basically a derivative. Gradient is a derivative for each variable of a function. For each variable of the function. The gradient symbol is usually an upside-down delta. So, upside-down triangle. Upside-down delta, this one, upside-down delta. And called del. This makes a bit of sense. Delta indicates change in one variable, and the gradient, del, is change in for all variables. So for example, gradient of f, x, y, z equal del f, x, y, z is basically f with respect to the x, f with this y, and f with this z. Actually, there is a slight error. This one, d, well, it is not the, it should be partial over here. They should be partial. This should be partial because it should be partial derivative. This one is not total derivative, partial derivative. So to make it rigorous, we change d into all partial over here. Notice how the x component of gradient is a partial derivative, right? The partial derivative with x. Similarly, second one is y-axis is a partial derivative with y, and so the partial derivative with z. So for one variable function, there is no y component at all, so the gradient is becomes derivative. So basically, gradient is more general, generalized version of derivative. Okay, so let's take a look at the example. F x y z is y x y square z square. So let's take a look at the example. So we have x y square z 3 power, let's say this is d x y z, and we want to calculate gradient of f, gradient of f, del f. Well, gradient is basically, well, I prefer writing down gradient in the column vector, so it is f over partial f over partial x, and partial f over partial y, and partial f over partial z. Well, it is the fx, fy, fz. It doesn't matter. You can write down this way or this way. It doesn't matter. But anyway, first, the partial fx is 1, and we take derivative with y, it is the 2y, because we treat other thing as constant, and if we take derivative with z, it's a 3z square, right, and we come this way, so del f is 1, 2y, 3z square, so this is a way to calculate gradient. Here, it is written as a row vector, it doesn't matter. Well, usually, however, the column vector, write down gradient as a column vector is a norm. So I recommend you to write gradient in terms of column vector, Heng matrix. Yeah. Column vector, yeah. 열 vector, not Heng vector, not row vector, okay? Now, another example. Well, now fxy equal x square y. And we want to find the del f 3, 2. And we find the derivative of f in the direction of 1, 2 at the point of 3, 2. Well, it is interesting. So, how we can calculate this one? So, first we have to take on we have to calculate partial derivative, right? Partial derivative. So, let's calculate only first part. So, let's delete this one. So, f. So, it is x square y. So, y, sorry, x squared y, and then del f, and then partial with respect to x, then partial with respect to y, and then this is the, we treat y as a constant, y fixed, so it is 2xy. And if we take derivative with y, partial derivative y, it is x squared. And it looks like this. Right? And we want to evaluate at the point 3, 2. Okay, 3, 2. At 3, 2. This is d. Then 3, 2. So 3, 2, 6, 12. And 3 squared, 9. 9. So 12, 9. right? So 12 knot. We have 12 and 9. Now the gradient is, so basically gradient is, yes, 3, 9. So sometimes this is basically, sometimes you write this one as 12. Here it is I plus 9 j, right? Direction of I. So here is I is, you can regard 0, 1, 0, and j equals c, 1, 0, 1, right? So basically, yeah, they are same. These are, they are same. Basically, they are same, okay? Now, another important concept is Hessian matrix. Hessian matrix is also very, very important concept in finance and economics. And in mathematics, the Hessian matrix or Hessian is a square matrix of second order partial derivatives of a scalar valued function or scalar field. It describes the local curvature. Local curvature. So it is curvature, it is like second derivative. In the single value function, Hessian matrix is equivalent to like a second derivative. So it describes the local curvature of a function of many variables. So in one variable, Hessian matrix is just the second derivative. So the Hessian matrix was developed in the 19th century by the German mathematician Ludwig Otto Hess, and later named after him. Hess originally used the term functional determinants. Specifically, suppose f is a mapping function from n-dimensional n-dimensional vector to one-dimensional vector, or n-dimensional space to one-dimensional space. From Rn to R is a function taking as input a vector x. X is the vector with n element. It has n element, so it is you can regard x as a point in n-dimensional space. So x in Rn, and outputting a scalar fx in R. Okay? If all second partial derivatives of f exist and are continuous over the domain of the function, and the Hessian matrix H of f is a square n by n matrix, usually defined and arranged as follows. So H is a second order, but collection of all partial derivatives, second order partial derivative. So partial square f, partial x square, partial square f, and x1, x2, x1, xn, and then now here x2, x1, and xn, x1, and then for intermediate i's row and j's column, hij is partial square f over partial x1 and partial xj, and we fill this one at i's row. In J's column, it is Hessian. So Hessian is like generalized second order derivatives. So let's take a look at it. Take a look at Wikipedia. Hessian matrix. Yes, this is Hessian. And then, yeah, it is used to calculate critical point. Yes. They are difficult, so you can skip it. Well, let's take a look at some example of Hessian matrix. So if you are interested in example of Hessian matrix, then you can Google it. Example Hessian. So you can Google. Let's go to Google. Google.com. So you type Hessian matrix examples. Hessian matrix example. Well, what? Which one you can take a look at it? Maybe Khan Academy article? Yeah, Khan Academy article. Let's take a look at it. Khan Academy article about Hessian matrix. So Hessian matrix. So here it is another well-written one. the Hessian matrix, the Hessian matrix of multivariate function f, x, y, z, which different also write as hf or h, f or h small f, they are all Hessian matrix of f, organizes all second partial derivative into a matrix. So hf, Hessian of f, Hessian f is like this one, as we learn. So two things to notice here. This only makes sense for scalar valued function. Okay, so the output is one dimensional. So output is multidimensional. Well, it does not make sense. Second, the object HF, Hessian of F, is no ordinary matrix. It's a matrix with a function as an entire entry. So entries of this matrix is a function. So it's a matrix made of function. In other words, it is meant to be evaluated at some point. So you can plug those numbers into Hessian and you get the number. As such, you might call this HF as a matrix valued function. One more important thing, the word Hessian, although sometimes refers to the determinant of this matrix instead of to the matrix itself. So sometimes it's confusing. The determinant, so it is matrix. So if it is matrix, square matrix, we will have a determinant. That determinant of this one is also Hessian, called sometimes Hessian. Maybe confusing. Now let's find the example. Here example is the fxy is x power of 3 minus 2xy minus y 6 at the point 1, 2. So at this particular point 1, 2, we want to calculate Hessian f, hf. First, we have to calculate partial derivative solution. Ultimately, we need all the second partial derivative f. So let's first compute both partial derivatives. So partial f over partial x, we take derivative of this one with this x, so 3x squared minus 2y, and fy xy is, now we take partial with y, so well, it goes away, minus 2x minus 6y5, minus 2x minus 6y5. Now we have this one. Now next we have to calculate partials of each. They are all, each of them, each first partial are in turn function of x and y, so we can calculate partial of this one with respect to xy and this one with respect to xy. So we have fxx, fxy, fyx, fyy. So fxx, we take this one with respect to x, so 3x squared minus 2y, so this all appears, so 6x. Now fxy is, now we take derivative, which is this one, this one, with this y, so it is the goes away, minus 2y minus 2, so minus 2. Now fyx, so where is fy? Fy, and now we have to take derivative one with respect to x, so it is delta, partial minus 2x minus 6y 5 over partial x, which is minus 2. Now fyy is this one with this y, so minus 2x minus 6y 5 minus 30y4. So we have this one. Okay. So basically, H, the Hessian matrix in this case, is a 2 by 2 matrix. So by the way, you can notice this one and this one same. So fxy and fyx is same. Actually, the general result, they are same. As you know, it doesn't matter to change the order of derivatives. So fxy and fyx are same. So Hessian matrix is basically symmetric. Symmetric, this one and this one same. So the Hessian matrix in this case is a 2 by 2 matrix with these functions as entries. Hf, xy is fxx, fxy, fyz, fyy, and then in this place, we fill them as entries. So hf is 6x minus 2 minus 2 minus 30, y4th power. Now we were asked to evaluate this at the point xy 1, 2. So we plug 1, 2 over here. So it is 6, 1, minus 2, minus 2, minus 30, 2, 2 to the 4th. So we have 6 minus 2 minus 2 minus 480. So Hessian of f at the point 1, 2 looks like this matrix. Now the problem is ambiguous, since as I told you, the Hessian can refer to entry, either can refer either to this matrix itself or to its determinant. What you want depends on context. For example, in optimizing multivariate functions, there is sometimes called the second partial derivative test, which uses the Hessian determinant, or shortly just Hessian. When the Hessian is used to approximate the functions, you just use the matrix itself. If it's the determinant we want, so in the problem, it's ambiguous, you know, it is ambiguous. Compute Hessian, so we don't know whether it's a Hessian matrix or determinant of Hessian matrix. So we can create determinant. So determinant of this one is this one minus this one, so minus 2,884. So where do we use this Hessian? By capturing all the second derivative information of a multivariate function, the Hessian matrix often plays a role analogous to ordinary second derivative in a single variable calculus. So it is a generalized version of second derivative. Most notably, it arises in these two cases. Quadratic approximation of multivariate function is a bit like a second order Taylor expansion. In finance, we are interested only second order, usually interested in second order Taylor expansion or Taylor approximation. So, and then second order Taylor approximation is special, so it is called quadratic approximation. So basically, we can use Hessian for multivariate function. The second partial derivative test, which helps you find the maximum minimum of multivariate function. So what's the quadratic approximation multivariate function? Let's click this. Yes, quadratic approximation. So quadratic approximation is basically for two, it looks like this one. In vector form, it is this one. So general form also, it is the multivariate version of a Taylor series expansion. So in the Google Taylor series expansion, Taylor series expansion, and then we have Taylor series in several variables. Taylor series of several variables. So Taylor series of several variables looks like this. Looks like this one. Well, complicated. And then for second order, d square. Actually, this is another notation for Hessian. Hessian, okay. So, example. Yeah. Example, we have interesting example. So, yeah, this one. Click. And then quadratic, let's go to quadratic approximation again. So, in vector form, looks like this one. So quadratic approximation f, so f quadratic approximation of f around x0 looks like this one. So it is like Taylor series expansion, and one variable, single variable Taylor series expansion, we have just df over dx. Now we have gradient instead, because gradient is general multivariate version of a first derivative. And here we have Hessian. We have Hessian because it's a general multivariate version of second order derivative. Anyway, the general form of this for a scalar valued function f with any kind of multi-dimensional input, here's what that approximate looks like. Okay, so f is similar to, so basically here, basically this one, is similar to, basically this one is the, well, here basically fx, let's write down over here, so fx, suppose we have fx, right, so fx here, this is a vector, so x is a vector. And then second order approximation, second order Taylor series approximation is useful, so we write it as a quadratic. We call it quadratic approximation. So it is quadratic of f here. That's why we have what? Quadratic f and is a function of x. And this is the second order Taylor approximation. That's why we have this one. And this is first, well, we want to evaluate at x0. Here it is evaluated x0. So first f x0, this is the same. This is the same as the single valued function. Now plus in the single variable Taylor series expansion, we have x prime x0. But now this x is now vector. This f, but x is a vector, right? So we cannot use on this one. So instead of this one, so therefore we have del f x0 and then x minus x0. Now it's a linear approximation. So this part is often called L f x, right? Because it's linear approximation. Okay, but here we are interested in quadratic approximation, so let's delete this one. Right, so we have this one. Oh, sorry, we have the multiplication. Okay, multiplication. And then, now, in Taylor series expansion, we have something like f2 prime, x2 prime, x naught, x minus x square, right? But now again, x is vector, and then f is the vector valued function. So therefore, we cannot write simply this one. So it is wrong. So instead of writing this one, we remove this part, right? And then actually, let's make more space, and then we write this one as the x minus x naught. Actually, we need to transpose over here. So it becomes the row vector and the h of f at x0 and x minus x naught. Something like this one, right? So it is almost like a Taylor series expansion, but it is a matrix version. So we have this one, transpose. So here, the first term is constant, and second term is linear term, and third term is quadratic term. I know it looks a bit complicated, but I'll step through it piece by piece later on. Here's a brief outline of each term. F. It's a function with multi-dimensional input and the scalar output. Function from R and n-dimensional space to one-dimensional space. Now, del f is gradient. Gradient of f evaluated at x naught. And hf x naught is a Hessian of f evaluated at x zero. And the vector x naught is a specific input, the one we are approximating near. The vector x represents the variable input. The approximate function qf has the same value as f at the point x naught. All its partial derivatives have the same value as those f at this point. And all its second partial derivatives has the same value as those f at the point. Well, that's the definition of Taylor series expansion. So it can be extended into multivariate function. I explained the intuition of Taylor series expansion in the previous lecture. And the title approximation. Imagine now you are given some function fxy with two input and one output. So fxy is sine x and cosine y. Now graph of sine x cosine y, let's take a look at it. Now, the goal is to find a simple function, quadratic approximation, that approximates this complicated function, this complex function, fxy, near some particular point x0, 5, 0. For example, what is the quadratic approximation, simple function, some approximative function at x0, y0, which is pi over 3 and pi over 6. Now, 0, 0 the approximation, so it is constant. We want to match this one, it's constant. So basically, at x0, y0, this f has the same value. The most naive approximation would be a constant function, which equals the value f at x0, y0, everywhere. We call this a 0 the approximation. So constant term, so f x0, y0 is a sine. So basically, we are just put this one into this one. So cxy equals sine pi over 3 cosine pi over 6, which is root 3 over 2. We know sine pi over 3 is root 3 over 2, and cosine pi over 6 is root 3 over 2. So multiply them, and 3 over 4. Now, written in abstract, this one is the constant function. Now, graphically, the graph of this approximation function cxy is a flat plane passing through the graph of a particular function at the point of this one. Okay. Below is the video showing how this approximation changes as we move the point x0, y0 around. Right? It is a plane, right? Basically, we are approximating the function with a constant function. Here, the graph of f is pictured in blue, and graph of the approximation white, and the point x naught, y naught, fx naught, y naught is pictured at the red dot. Red dot over here, red dot. And then this is the, yes, white, and blue is the curve. Now, first order approximation. Now, the constant function, zero order approximation, is pretty lousy. Sure, it's the guaranteed to equal fxy at the point x naught, y naught, but that's about it. One step better is to use local linearization. Local is also known as first order approximation of Taylor series expansion. So, write the example. LFXY is this one, 3 over 4 plus root 3, 4, x minus 5 over 3 plus minus root 3 over 4, y minus pi over 6. Written in the more abstract, it is the LF, linear approximate f at xy, x0, y0, or first order Taylor series approximation of f is at approximate at x0, y0 is fx0, y0 plus fx, x0, y0, x minus x0, and fy, x0, y0, y minus y0. Here, fx and fy denote the partial derivative of f. Graphically, the graph of local linearization is the plane tangent to the graph of f at the point. Here is the video showing how this approximation changes as we move around the point x0, y0. So, yeah, this x0, y0 moves, yet the tangent plane changes. Right? Pretty cool, isn't it? Now, the second order approximation, better still is a quadratic approximation, also a second order approximation with second order Taylor series expansion that Finance likes. The remainder of this article is devoted to the finding and understanding the analytic form of the such an approximation. But before diving in, let's see what such approximation look like graphically. You can think of this approximation as the nesting into the curve, the graph at the point x0, y0, fx0, y0, giving it a sort of mathematical hook. Right? Now, quadratic means product of two variables. In single variable function, the word quadratic refers to any situation where a variable is squared, as in terms of x squared. With multiple variable, quadratic refers not only to square terms like x squared, y squared, but also terms that involve the product of two variables, x, y. In general, the order of the term, which is the product of several things, such as 3x squared y third is a total number of variables multiplied into that term. In this case, the order would be 5. 2x is 3y's, and the constant doesn't matter, so it is fifth order. Now, graphs of a quadratic function. One way to think of a quadratic function in terms of their convexity, which might depend on which direction you are moving in, is a function has an upward convexity, as in the case, for example, with fxy equal x squared plus y squared, the graph will look like this one. So it is called upward concavity. From upward, it is concavity. But from below, it is convex. So it is upward concavity. Okay, so yeah, other parts are really interesting. And then let's skip this one. Reminder on the local linearization. Recipe is that it is a first order approximation, so LFXY is constant plus partial FX and partial FY. So this is a constant linear term. Now, quadratic approximation is we need one more term, quadratic term. So, quadratic approximation F, which is a second order Taylor series expansion, order of 0, first order, so basically is partial F, partial y, and then square terms, quadratic part. Yeah, something like this. So in the end, we have looked like this. Now, let's look at the example, approximating sine x cosine y. Now, find the quadratic approximation of sine x cosine y at the point of x, y. Now, you can check it. You can solve this problem, and you will get the answer. So, the quadratic approximation of cosine x sine y would be like this one. Yeah, nice quadratic approximation. Now, vector notation using Hessian. Perhaps it goes without saying that the expression for the quadratic approximation is long. Now imagine if f has three inputs, x, y, z. In principle, you can imagine how this might go, adding terms involving fz, fxz, fzz, on and on, with all three partial derivatives, and all nine, because we have three, so three by three, so nine. Nine second partial derivatives. But this would be a total nightmare. Now imagine you are writing a program to find the quadratic realistic approximation of a function with 100 input. That would be madness. It actually doesn't have to be that bad. When something is not that complicated in principle, it shouldn't be that complicated in notation. Quadratic approximations are a little complicated, sure, but they are not absurd. Using all factors and matrices, specifically the gradient and Hessian of f, we can write the quadratic approximation as follows. So, quadratic approximation of f around the x0 is a constant term, linear term, and quadratic term. Okay, so let's break this down. Then we have this one, and this one, and this one. Okay. So this is the end of today's class. Thank you.